All right. Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Lakes. And so we're excited to worship here together. I hope everybody had a wonderful, 4th of July this week and a great time. The weather has been great, although we all know we could use some rain. Hey, you get to cut your grass a little less right now. Or just cut the weeds. So I'm excited for church today. I'm excited to worship with you. We're kind of throwing it back for worship this morning. So some of you may really appreciate that. We're gonna sing a set pretty much full of hymns. And there's a reason for this, okay? I know that's not our normal, quote-unquote, worship. But what is worship? What is it? What does it look like? What does it mean to you? And so today for worship, we're going back to the foundation. You see, because the reason that we gather here is all because of what Jesus did on Calvary, all because of that cross, all because of what Jesus did for you and me. And the gospel is eternal. The gospel is timeless. And so this morning, as we sing these songs and as we express our worship together as a congregation, the message of these songs is timeless. The love that these songs talk about, the grace, the blessings, the foundation that these songs talk about is the timeless gospel. And these all, we're not going to get into the, although it would be really cool, the background story of each one of these songs and why they were written and, how they were written hundreds of years ago or whatever it might be, but the love of Jesus is just as present as the moment that these songs were written. And the love of Jesus and the presence of the Lord is just as present here today as it was on the moment that Jesus gave up his life on the cross. And the moment that he rose again from the dead. Jesus died for you and he died for me. And so as we enter into worship here today, and as we sing these songs of praise and adoration, I just invite you to reflect on the simple thing that Jesus died for you. Jesus gave it all up for you. And this is why we gather together today in worship. To worship the one who would come and lay down his life for me. So Lord, we thank you. Jesus, we just invite you into this place. We say, let your presence come and move. Lord, I pray for each person here, Lord, that they will be touched by the gospel this morning, that they will be touched by your presence, your goodness, your fullness. Lord, I pray that we will know that you are alive. Lord, we thank you. We worship you. We praise you, Lord. You are holy. You are worthy. Lord, let us hold nothing back from expressing our love to you today. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you are able, we invite you to stand with us and sing this morning.
Songs of loudest praise. Teach me songs. Oh God, we declare your faithfulness and your goodness. We stand in awe of you. That there is no shadow in you, but you are nothing but light and goodness. You are an amazing God. And you take such good care of us. We trust in your faithfulness. We trust in your goodness. You are the promise keeper. We trust in you. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to enter into a time of communion. And so you can find the elements in the seat in front of you or maybe on the seat, on your own seat. But here at the Lakes, we have open communion. That means if you trust in Jesus as your Savior, you're welcome to take communion with us, to participate with us. Today we sang about God being good and God being faithful. And as I was praying this morning and asking the Lord what he wanted for his people, I saw this picture of a bunch of sheep where you guys are. And really what he was saying was, I want to care for my sheep today. I want to take really good care of them and check them over and look for wounds and look for hurting places. I want to make sure that they don't have stickers and thorns stuck in them. I want to love on them. The Lord desires to draw near to you. Will you open your heart to him today? In Psalm 23, there's this beautiful picture of the Lord taking care of us. David writes, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He takes me to lush pastures. He leads me to refreshing waters. He restores my strength. He leads me down the right paths for the sake of his reputation. Even when I must walk through the darkest valley, I fear no danger, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff reassure me. You prepare a feast for me in plain sight of my enemies. You refresh my head with oil. My cup is completely full. Surely your goodness and faithfulness will pursue me all of my days, and I will live in the Lord's house for the rest of my life." We serve a God who is awesome and holy and out of this world amazing. And we also serve a God who is close, who is near, and who cares for our hearts individually. We serve a God who thought we were such worthwhile sheep that he would come and shed his own blood and give his own body to rescue us. And so the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he gave thanks, saying, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus, you took on a body, the most precious and holy that there ever was, and you broke it and you gave it up for us. And we say thank you. Thank you for caring that much for us, that you came and you gave your own body. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's take of the bread together. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink of it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for your blood that heals us. We thank you for your blood that clothes us in righteousness. We thank you for your blood that brings us near into your presence. We thank you for your great sacrifice. We thank you. In Jesus' precious name we pray, amen. Let's drink of the cup together. Now, if you would, let's pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. If you would, as you sit down, say hello to someone. Let them know that they're really good-looking sheep. Love to do here at the Lakes is to declare what the Lord is doing, to celebrate with one another, and to lift up and give praise and glory where it is due, and that is to Jesus. And so we want to say what he's doing in our lives, where we've seen him at work, what scripture has he brought to our attention, what word does he have for this congregation, or what prayer has he answered. If you would, just raise your hand, and we'll come and find you with a microphone, and let's give praise to the Lord where it is due.
Hi, I'm Laura, and I'm really exuberant today. Today I've been married 57 years to the same man. But I want you to know that it's not because old habits are hard to break. It's because when things... And trust me, in marriage, things do get a little rocky sometimes. When things got rocky, I would have God in my life, and I would pray, please, let me see this man through your eyes. Amen. Because right now, I think he's not the man I married. So let me see him through your eyes.
Amen.
And it always worked. And I would also pray, please give me an attitude adjustment. And that always worked. And so all of you younger people who are married, don't ever let God leave your life, because God will hold you together.
Amen. Thank you, Laura.
I was going to share this last week. However, things went kind of long, and so I didn't. But I'm going to share this week, and these are my notes, so it won't be quite as long. This is the smallest Post-it note you can buy. So 2 weeks ago, we had our family reunion, which we've been having every year for 120 years. I haven't been to all of them. I hope that's obvious. But many of the last 70 or so, I've been there. It was the 120th wedding anniversary of my grandparents, John and Nina. We called them Papa and Nanny. And at this reunion on Sundays, out in front of the barn on the original farm, we have a church service. And one of the things I shared was a verse that's special in our family. It's John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. My grandfather, John, Pup, we called him Pup, not Papa John, not the pizza guy, but at the end of his life, he was at St. Michael's Hospital in Stevens Point. And John was on the third floor in room 316. Each room had a Bible verse on the door. His room was John 3:16. John died at 3:16. The old pendulum clock on the farm where we were at a couple weeks ago in the kitchen, it stopped at 3:16. Papa and Nanny had a new electric clock in their bedroom that stopped at 3:16. So that is just a strong message to me that Papa did not perish but has eternal life, as is promised in John 3:16 to all who believe in Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else? All right. Becky almost got called on because she was waving at a neighbor. All right. Thank you guys for sharing. It is just a great thing to boost our faith, to see how God's at working throughout our church family. And so we really appreciate that. So at this time, it's time for our kids to be dismissed to the kids ministry. Bye, kids. We love you. Bye, youth. We love you, too. And you're welcome to join William in the fellowship hall. It is a great day to bless our children and young people.
All right. Well, good morning. Welcome. Welcome, welcome. Can I real fast have Jesse and Carolyn? Amanda. Okay. You weren't by your mom, so I was looking for you. Can I have you guys come forward? Just come on. Come on up. Carolyn told me that Jesse wants to be the one to announce this. And so, go ahead, Jesse.
Well, if you haven't heard already, we did build a float for Heavenly Sleep, the Lakes, and Shindig for the 4th of July parade. We took first place. So, their family, my family, it was a fun time together. I don't know if any of you have seen the float, but it did start out as a greenhouse frame, and now it looks like a house. So,
it was awesome.
It was an awesome time, and thank you everybody that came out and helped hand out stuff in the parade. It was wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you so much, you guys. You can be seated. I just wanted to recognize, because I know so much people worked hard on it. You know, yeah, we recognize Sleep in Heavenly Peace, which Amanda leads, Project Backpack, obviously the Lakes Church and the Children's Center that's coming, and then Shindig. I loved the Shindig's closed on Sundays, but the Lakes isn't. It was just a great time, and we won first place in the best float, so that's always good, because I like to win things. And so now the pressure's on for next year because we need to be bigger and better. That's awesome. You know, we want to be in the community and so that was a fun way. The parade was really fun. I couldn't believe how many people came out. There was a lot of people, a lot of kids, but that's awesome. So a couple quick announcements here that I have. First off, if you have any youth who are not going to our epic campout this weekend, we would love to invite you. And I really believe that the Lord is going to touch the lives of our youth. And we all know that there are so many things that are infiltrating our youth's brain in our culture. And so we want to infiltrate it with the gospel and the love of Jesus. And so that's what's going to happen this weekend. And so sign up for that. If you have any questions, you can talk to Pastor Amy or William, we'd really love. So that's for middle school and high school age students. And then also this week on Thursday is we have a women's event. So we would love for all of you ladies in the room to check out the women's event this week on Thursday. And then last but not least, tomorrow morning, we are going to start some renovations on the lower level of our building, preparing for the children's center that we are hoping to still launch in the fall. That is the goal. So for that to happen, we need lots of help. And so you are invited. If you can make it tomorrow morning, we invite you to come. And if you can, be there at 8 a.m., that's awesome. But there's help for people of all ages and abilities. And, you know, there's going to be cleaning. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. And one of the ways that we can do this without taking out a massive loan is through you guys and through volunteers. And so I can't believe what we did last time. You know, all of this is because of volunteers that put in a lot of work, and it's beautiful. And so we're gearing up for another one here, and that starts tomorrow. And so today we are going to talk about a topic that is near and dear to my heart, and it's one of the reasons that Haley and I are here. And so a little bit about my story. So I grew up in a Christian home, and I was really blessed, blessed with two parents who really loved the Lord. And my parents really pointed me towards Jesus. And there's one thing, you know, for children, especially, you know, as a youth pastor, you really encounter a lot of kids with different dynamics of how their parents serve the Lord. you'll have some parents who drop their kids off on Wednesday nights, or drop their kids off for church, and then they go and be like, awesome, we get a quiet house for an hour, or they go to dinner or something like that, and their kids never experience their parents leading in church. You have some parents where maybe one of the parents goes to the church and the other one hates church and sits at home. You have some parents who go to church but complain about going to church and how miserable going to church is, but yet they're there every Sunday and they make their kids go every Sunday, and thus their kids also complain about going to church every Sunday. And you have some parents who love church and raise their children to love church. And so that's the category that my parents fell in. And one of the things that we're going to start looking at as a church family, and I believe the Lord is gearing us up for something really exciting. And we're going to look at the topic of worship. And what is worship? What does it look like? How is it expressed? What is it? What is the definition of worship? And so when I look at my parents, I know I shared a story of a few weeks ago of a lady who called into the radio station on Father's Day who said, you know, the thing that she was most thankful that her father taught her was to sing really loud in church. That was one of the things that he taught her. And when I look at my parents, so both of my parents, my mom is actually here today, and she had to get out of singing on the worship team at her church. And my dad probably sang on the worship team at at the church that I grew up in. They were on the worship team almost every single Sunday. And not only did they express worship on Sunday mornings, but they expressed it throughout the week in the way that they lived their lives. And so for me, worship has sunk deep into who I am, and expressing worship was always just the natural response to the presence of God. And as Haley and I were getting, I won't go too far down this rabbit trail because there's so many things involved, but before we came and were invited to come to this church, Haley and I were in a really dry season of our faith. Has anybody ever been there before? Like, we started to hate going to church. You know, our story kind of in a nutshell is, you know, we were pastoring in Texas, outside of Austin, and we got hurt. Some of our leaders made a poor decision, and we were hurt, and so we wanted to come home. So we came home hurt and broken, and the Lord was beautiful and sweet. And we started working in the church that I grew up in, and doing a lot of things, and I met a lot of great people, and met Pastor Phil and Gene, and they ended up following us here, and we're thankful for them. But anyways, you know, we left Austin, which Austin, Texas, if you don't know, Austin claims to be the real music capital of the world. You know, there's Nashville, obviously, that maybe, but you go to Austin, and Austin's very adamant they are the musical capital of the world. Okay, so like we had in our church so many talented people, like the third and fourth string worship leaders in our church right now are living in Los Angeles because they have record deals and things and publishing music. Like you know, and I remember the one time his name's Zach. He won America's Got Talent, and our worship leader wouldn't let him sing because he didn't know the worship heart yet. Like the talent in the church and the worship heart was like something that you just don't see in Wisconsin, okay? Like, Wisconsin is not the musical capital of the world, okay? Like we don't have world-class guitar players just, like, walking in the building randomly all the time, right? So for us, like, being in Austin was worship was just this experience, and it was... it really introduced me to a whole new thing because I grew up in very Midwest style church. Like we worshiped and we believed in God and we talked about the Holy Spirit. But when we went to Texas, we were given the opportunity to, I believe, really encounter the Holy Spirit through worship. And so then when we came back, we were hurting and it's really hard to minister and from a place where you're hurting and we missed the worship experiences and we missed our we had a bunch of youth that we loved and we were hurting and we got to a place where we began to really dread going to church because we knew that there is a God out there who wants to engage with your heart and engage with your life. Like, we knew what it was like when the Lord came in the room and we all fell on our face and started crying. You know, you see this man who's got calloused hands and never has shown emotion in his entire life, and he's falling on his face crying because the presence of the Lord is there. Like, we knew what that felt like, and we felt like we were going to a place where we go to church and people just sit there and they're just going through the motions and there's nothing special about the God that they're worshiping. And as a pastor in that situation, I felt like, you know, there was this idea of like we have to beg people to respond to the cross. And I had made a, you know, you're not supposed to make promises to God, but I had made a commitment to the Lord that, like, if I ever was not ministering out of love and out of the overflow of my heart, like, I'm going to leave ministry. And so Haley and I got to a point where, like, we were making plans to walk away. Because our heart wasn't, responding to the people around us in the right way. We'll say it that way. We longed for something different. And so around the same time, the Lord, you know, we had options. You know, I had option A, which was, you know, I was going to start my own business and do some things in construction and working, you know, with churches and stuff on whatever. And that sounded really attractive. I felt like I could probably make some money doing it. And then, but the door for option B, which was to stay in ministry, was always open, I guess. But I didn't want to go somewhere. I didn't want to just take the situation I was in and move it to a different spot, to a different church. And the Lord led us to apply for one job and one position, even though I missed the deadline, apparently. And the Lord brought Haley and I here to the lakes. And I'll tell you this, the reasoning for that is because it's solely, the only reason that Haley and I made the decision to come here is because the first time we walked in here, we saw people who wanted to know Jesus. There was nothing else. Like, it wasn't because, it wasn't because it was a great experience. It wasn't because, you know, that we had world-class talent. You know, it wasn't because it was polished. It wasn't because... You know, it wasn't even honestly, I think the Lakes is the most friendly people that we've ever met in a church. Like, we feel so, received the way that we were greeted, and just the people that I've met here are great, but it wasn't the people. It wasn't any of that. It was the way that this church hungered for Jesus. Because I had gotten to a place in my heart where I would have rather worshiped with one or two people who actually wanted to know the Lord than worship with 10,000 people and claim about, look at the church that we built. It's so big. Look at all the people who are responding to the Lord. I felt like here there was a genuine response to Jesus. And so that's why we're here. And, you know, like, I was looking at our mission statement, which is up on the wall over there. We were wondering where to put that, and so I just threw it on the shelf. It's not even anchored there yet. But I was looking at it this morning, and I thought, like, you can totally tell that Pastor Amy wrote that. And so sometimes I'm like, you know, it would have been, I'm very opinionated, and it would have been nice to maybe, like, you wrote all of these values and mission statements before Haley and I came here. And so, but when I, you know, when we looked at your core values, the very first core value, which is on the wall above the bathrooms, if you don't know that, our four core values, when you look at it, it says, we are passionate about Jesus. We intentionally pursue a personal and intimate relationship with God. That's the first core value of what we believe here at the Lakes. And so when Haley and I began to research the Lakes and to see it, this is a place that we wanted to be a part of. And, you know, we've been able to enjoy the last year and a half it's been now about of worshiping with you guys, of growing with you guys. The work that the Lord has done to heal our hearts and to restore our faith in the church has been amazing. And, you know, I don't ever feel like, I feel like I can love the Lord and that you guys respond to that. And that's my greatest dream as a pastor. And so we are going to dive into this idea of, like, what does worship look like? Because it is the number one core value of our church. It is what we stand on. We intentionally pursue a personal and intimate relationship with God. That is through worship. And so what does worship look like? So that's one question that I want to ask you today. And the second question that I want to ask you, because this is, I think, the foundation. Before we can talk about what worship is, before we can talk about the idea of it is, we need to know what the foundation of why we're here and what we're looking at is. And so let me ask you this question. What is the greatest Christian experience? So if you, some of you might be answering this question in your head about your, but let's try to think biblically. Like what does the Bible say is the greatest Christian experience or achievement? You know, some of you might be saying, like, we can look at a couple different areas. We can look at the Great Commission, right? To go into all of the nations. You know, and so to share the gospel with somebody and to see somebody else, you know, to have the privilege to be the one to lead somebody else to Jesus, right? That is quite the experience. That is quite the privilege of the Lord. Or maybe it's to serve in missions. And to go out and to love the Lord. And so I want to look at a verse that I believe is going to answer this question today. And but let's look at this. The greatest Christian experience, what is it? I want to read this verse. I'm switching up my order here. So look at this verse. So we studied, if you go back to last year, we studied the book of Revelation, or the first few chapters of Revelation. And we studied what the churches are. And there's this verse about the church. And so this is the very first thing that Jesus says to the churches. He says this in Revelation chapter 2, verses 4 through 5. It says, "Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love that you had at first." And so if you remember how, you know, we study this, Jesus is calling out what their mistake is first. And then there's a consequence to follow, right? And so what does Jesus say? He says, "You have forsaken the love you had at first," or "you have forgotten your first love." But then listen to what it says after this. It says, "Consider how far you have fallen." It doesn't say, "Consider how great of a mistake you have made." Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things that you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, which is a scary judgment that could come upon them if they don't repent. But what does it mean to consider how far you have fallen? And so this verse, along with some other verses that you can apply to this in Scripture, has led scholars to believe this statement, that loving Jesus is the great experience of the Christian experience. It's the greatest feat. It's the highest mountain that you can climb. There is nothing that is greater than loving Jesus. There is no spot that is greater. And this is something, you know, as we talk about worship and as we look at this, this is something that I think is so critical for us to know. Because, like, I think when we, you know, when we talk about this idea of worship, maybe a lot of you are like, "Oh, well, are you going to make me raise my hands?" Or we'll compare. Does somebody who raises their hands, do they worship more passionately than somebody who doesn't? Many people would say yes. Or does somebody who sings worship more passionately than somebody who doesn't sing? Many people would say yes. Does singing praise and worship songs at church encompass what worship is? Many people would say yes. But the answer to all those things is worship is different for each and every one of us. And so here's where I want to talk about the foundation of what worship is. And so here's what I believe worship is this. Is your expression of worship is equal to who God has become to you. Okay? So worship is your response to who God is to you. Does that make sense? That's as simple as I can, you know, we can get a lot of definitions of worship, but this is as simple as I can break it down. Worship is your response to who God is to you. And so, you know, one of the pictures that you know, it's really easy for me to give is sports teams, right? You'll hear this a lot when people are talking about. I mean, how many of you guys are Packers fans in the room, right? Really? I mean, I know it's not football season, but that was kind of lame. I don't want to say who's a Bears fan because then we will excommunicate them from the church, Rick. But when we, you know, when you picture, like if you go to Lambeau Field, it is an experience like no other, right? It has the history, it has the culture, plus you're standing next to some guy who's really, really overweight, who's not wearing a shirt and wearing striped overalls in green and gold, and he's probably drank way too much beer, and he stinks, and he's just yelling as loud as he possibly can, right? Like, it is an experience and this expression like no other, and that is because that person, and you probably because you're there, because you love the Green Bay Packers. Like, if you don't like football, and if you don't really care about the Packers, then you're probably kind of just sitting there hanging out. And it's a similar thing of our expression of worship. We worship many things in our life. We all struggle with worshiping money. You all struggle with worshiping your finances. I guarantee it. There is a temptation to worship and cling to your finances. And maybe you express that through disappointment. But you have an expression of how you are connected with your finances. Or we worship our jobs. Or we worship our relationships. Or we worship our spouses, and there's a response, and so your expression, this expression of worship and how you love things and work and intermingle with things is equal to what it has become to you. And this is the same thing when it comes to who God is. And this is all of this is going to this point that I want to make today. And this, today is kind of, it's a simple point, and it's this idea. The greatest experience that we can have as a Christian is to love Jesus. But if we don't have an expression of worship, then we don't know who God is. And we don't know what he's done for us. And we don't understand the gospel. And I don't want you to get caught on what you look like when we're singing songs as a church. Because I know we all look differently. I want you to think about what does your life look like when you think about the Lord. How much between Monday and Saturday do you express worship to the Lord? How much do you think about Him? How much do you live for Him? Who has God become to you? And so I want to share a quote that I heard for the first time from a pastor. His name is Michael Koulianos, and he shares this story of how, you know, he heard it for the first time when he was really struggling. He was in a spot of his life where he was struggling and didn't know what to do in ministry. And he was talking to some people who could give him advice, right? We all love people to give us advice. And so he went to these people and he's like, what should I do? Should I go and plant a church here? Should I Should I just give up in the church and become an evangelist? Should I travel around? What should I do with my family? Where should we move? What should we do? And he said he was getting so angry because the person that he was talking to just gave him the same answer every single time. Has anybody ever had an experience like that where you really want somebody to give you advice and all they do is give you the same one-line answer every single time? And this was the line that this person gave him. Find the love of Jesus and love him back. He's like, what should I do to serve the Lord? Find the love of Jesus and love him back. Where should we go to plant this church? Find the love of Jesus and love him back. Where should I move my family? Find the love of Jesus and love him back. And this, I found, the Lord was beautiful in the way that he did this, because when Haley and I were in this transitionary stage and as we started approaching this time of like, we know that we need to leave the situation that we're in, and what is next? What is the next thing? I found this in the same time that the Lord was leading us here to the lakes. I heard this for the very first time. And it was like everything, all the confusion that we were in, all the hurt, all the wondering of like, what do we do, Lord? Like this world is broken. We don't know where to do. We don't know where to go. We don't know what to do. And this is what broke through our lives in such a powerful, it broke through in my heart in a powerful way. Because the place that the Lord brought me is, I just want to find where I can love Jesus. That's all I want to do. I don't care what I do for a job. I don't care what house we live in. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care how much money we make. All I want to do is find the love of Jesus and love him back, because I've experienced it before, and I need to get back to that place where I can feel and experience the love of Jesus on a daily basis, and then I can love him back with the way that I live my life. There's no greater achievement than to find the love of Jesus and to love him back. And so what does that look like? Well, that's what we're going to talk about in the coming weeks and months and years. Because worship is the way that we are called to live. We believe, like I believe in missions. I believe that that's really important. I believe that it's really important for us to share the gospel with the people around us. I believe in taking care of the poor. Jesus told us to love the poor. But you want to know the truth? The truth is that we can be really, really good at that and still go to hell. What did Judas say a few days before Jesus was betrayed? Don't you know we could be giving this money to the poor? Look at King Saul. He was chosen by the Lord. And Scripture says that King Saul died as if he was never anointed. Man, we can do so many things for the Lord but never know him. I love, Dar, what you shared. You shared such a simple verse. That is the entirety of the gospel. That Jesus is our Lord and our Savior. There's nothing more. There's nothing more important than Jesus becoming the love of our lives. He is our hope. And we need to make him our Lord and Savior. Otherwise, nothing we do matters. And so, I want to just invite you guys today to think about, what does your heart say about Jesus? How does your heart respond to Jesus? Where does loving Jesus start? Well, loving Jesus starts with one thing, and it starts with this cross right here and what Jesus did on the hill of Calvary. Jesus expressed his love to you by going and dying on a cross and laying down his life for you, so that you would not have to experience the pain and the death that sin brings. And so that literally the reason that Jesus came and he died on a cross is so that heaven can come and live inside of you. That the presence of God can come and live inside of you. And so this morning, as we're gonna sing one more song here. So worship team, you guys can come back up. And as we sing this song, I just want to invite you to reflect, who is Jesus to you? You know, because if I'm being honest in my life, you know, I feel like I know Jesus in a way that, you know, 3 years ago I would have been like, I knew, 3 years ago I knew nothing. And today I still feel like I know nothing, but I knew enough that there was more. And you know, one of the things that as I look back that I almost regret about my life is like I had to lose that culture that we were in Texas, where we were surrounded, you know, we love worship. We did tons of worship things. And like we were surrounded by it. I had to lose it to realize how important Jesus was to me. And we can take it for granted so much. I took it for granted that my parents every single weekend were on the stage leading us in worship. You know, I've shared this before, but I took it for granted. Like, I didn't understand the love that my mom had for the Lord as she was sitting in that chair in her battle with cancer and still journaling and worshiping and spending time with the Lord. All of these things I took for granted. And now I'm in this stage of my life over the last 2 years where I've began to see what I believe that Jesus wants, the life that Jesus wants us to live, as a response to his love for us, as a response to how much he loves us. He just wants us to love him. Above all else, above anything else, he just wants us to love him and to stop and to say, Jesus, you're more important than whatever else it is on my mind. And so this morning, I want us to have an opportunity here as we sing this song to just take a moment and pause and to say, Jesus, you are more important than anything else on my mind. And to express your love to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There's nothing that you need to do. I just feel like the Lord wants to push back on that. There's just that sickness that gets in us, like, oh, I just have to do this, or if I just do this, I can follow the Lord. All you need to do is go before the cross and to say, thank you, Jesus, I love you. So I don't know what it is that, you know, if there's anything that's keeping you from there, but just, it doesn't need to be there. Doesn't need to be there. And so, Lord, I just thank you that you loved us. We can love you because you first loved us. Lord, I thank you that you gave up your life so that we could have eternal life, Lord, that we could experience your love and your joy and your goodness. But eternity is not for tomorrow. Eternity is not just for death. Eternity is for today. So, Lord, we pray as you taught us to pray that heaven would come to earth. Lord, I pray right now in this moment that we would experience a taste of heaven as we look to you. As we look to your face. As we look to the one who wore a crown of thorns and who paid a dear price for our lives. As we look to you, Lord, I pray that our hearts would respond in love. And Lord, that you would move in this place. So Jesus, we worship you today. We love you today. Teach us to follow your ways. Teach us to love you more, Lord. So that we can experience your presence. We love you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. want to challenge you this week. A simple challenge. My challenge to you this week is every single day to do one thing. To love Jesus that day. Just one thing. How can I love you today, Jesus? What is one thing that I can do? Maybe it's a great challenge to read your Bible every single day. But don't read your Bible just to read it. Read it because you love the Lord and you want to know more about His heart. Maybe you want to serve somebody, but do it because you're serving the Lord, because you love Him. Do one thing every single day because you love Jesus. Maybe it's just to be nice to your spouse. But do it because you love the Lord. And you know that you can forgive your spouse because you are forgiven. But we thank you, we thank you, we thank you. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. I just pray this simple blessing. I pray that the Lord's face shines upon you this week. Just the smile and the goodness of the Lord, that He shines upon you this week. Go in peace, everybody. We love you. If you need prayer for anything, we'll have members of our prayer team up front. We would love to be able to come and partner with you. Otherwise, have a wonderful week, everybody, and we will see you next week.